Hey, good evening. My name is Rich Sharp, and I'd like to welcome everyone to our show. We call it Tournament Horse Racing, brought to you by Broke Guys Handicapping. Here's how it works. We've broken the horse racing calendar into four separate tournaments, and each tournament consists of approximately 10 racing days. We pick four races from each of those racing days, and we compete against each other for prizes. We have four horse players, and each player will make a mythical $2 win place bet in each of the four races that day. We measure return on investment, or ROI, so the horse player with the highest ROI after four races wins that day. And the horse player with the highest overall ROI after 10 weeks is the winner of that tournament. At the end of the year, we will have four individual tournament winners and one year-end champion based on total ROI for the entire year. Well, that's how the tournament works, and now it's time to introduce you to our horse players. Going to go in time zone order tonight, and I'm going to start all the way on the East Coast in Staten Island, New York, with my good friend Ray Tirado. Ray, in preface of the holiday, Happy New Year. How have you been, my friend?
Very good, Rich. Thank you. Happy New Year to you. Glad to be here.
Yeah, absolutely. And we're going to come back to the West Coast here, and I'm going to introduce you to my leader to the South. He's coming to us from Temecula, California, Joe English. How have you been, my friend?
Doing well, Rich. Happy New Year to both of you and to everybody out there in podcast land.
Happy New Year to you. Happy New Year to your wife and your children. And same goes for you, Ray, your wife and your kids.
Thank you. You too.
Last day of the year. Last day. I think I look back on it like that. You and Ray and I, as three broke guys handicapping, 7 years of handicapping together. Normally doing it on Friday nights. We're on a Thursday night tonight. But always happy to handicap with the two of you.
Always.
Look forward to it.
We have a reminder that Joe, Ray, normally we have a fourth handicapper. His name is Steve, but he's not here tonight. And myself, we're all friends. We do the show for fun, and we try not to take ourselves too seriously. We are not a touting service, and we are not recommending or selling our picks in these races. We're just horse players who love our sport and enjoy competing against each other for fun. We hope you do as well. And with that being said, we are going to go ahead and head over to a recap of what we saw last week. So, Joe and Ray, I'm going to go ahead and start sharing my screen with you guys. And I'll bring that up for us here. And this was last week. And Joe, a little bit, Ray, as you see here, Ray Tirado with $46.10 from just three picks last week. So, Ray not only was not able to join us last week, he missed last week's handicapping show. But in addition to that, when he sent me his picks, one of his picks actually scratched that day. Santa Anita was off the turf on Sunday, and Ray didn't even send me a replacement pick. So he did this with only three picks. Joe, I feel like he was almost like he was showing us the football as he was throwing the, you know, crossing the goal line last week.
No, we had the party. Sanders. I totally forgot. It was like crazy, crazy day. I looked and I said, oh man, if this race got away from me, but it's all right. The last race did very well.
Weird day with the grass grassroots being taken off. Yeah, it was just a weird day.
So as you see there, Ray takes the victory. He gets the win over in the right-hand column. That would be our tiebreaker. Again, we measure ROI on this show. So Ray jumps out to a big lead here in the preseason, $46.10. Ray, I told the guys last week, so I'm not sure if you got a chance to watch the episode.
I did watch it.
Yeah, this is just going to be our preseason. We've got, as you see there, four actual race days with a break next week that'll come up. And then on January the 29th, we're going to kick off our main show for the year. So. Again, congratulations to you, Ray. Always nice to get a win. All right, we are going to be moving over to Gulfstream Park for our New Year's. This is the New Year's Day event there at Gulfstream Park. We are starting off this pick four. The pick four for us, or the four races that we'll be handicapping in our tournament, I should say, for Tournament Horse Racing Night, are races 7 through 10 at Gulfstream Park. The first race up is race number 7. They're going 6 furlongs on the main surface. This is the Limehouse Stakes. The purse is $100,000 for 3-year-olds only. And your morning line favorite is out here in post number 5. I want to make sure I say his name correct. I believe that is Lightning Larry. And he is trained by Jeff Engler and ridden by Romero Romag. Is 3-1. Juicy 3-1 morning line favorite on the Gulfstream Park morning line. Ray, you won last week. You weren't here last week, so nobody got to hear about your brilliant handicapping styles. go ahead and kick us off. Who do you like here in the Limehouse Stakes?
Well, first of all, he's a 3-year-old, and being January 1st, I just want to wish a happy birthday to all the horses.
Oh, there we go.
And all the newly turned 3-year-olds in the race. You know, they're 2 turning 3, and, you know, hopefully get some of them make it to the Triple Crown and stuff like that, and all the exciting 3-year-old races, and all the older horses. It's kind of a tricky race for me. It's a sprint. The Limehouse was a sprinter. I remember him from a few years back.
Oh, yeah.
But I fell in the number 3, Over Revolution. He's 4-1 with Tyler Gaffion, Safi Joseph, and he's undefeated in 2 starts. He's a type of horse. He doesn't seem to need the lead. He's kind of like a push button type of horse. And the breeding says he's 1 turn. He's out of McLean's Music and Salt Lake Mare. I don't think Zayas actually had him, has asked him for his best yet. This actually is a good class test for him because he's eligible still for 9 winners of 2. If you pull up the PP, though, you have them. Mm-hmm. And I can see him in the mid pack, which horses have done well on this all-weather course. And I think, but actually, the connections might have him pounded the windows. Because of the connections, you know, I think they're going to bet him heavy. So 4-1, I don't know, I'm hoping for 3-1 at least to get something out of him. But he looks pretty good in his 2 out races. So I'll go with number 3, of a Revolution, the Tyler Gaff and Safi Joseph.
Well, you know what? I'm going to follow you. I'm going to jump in front of Joe here, and I'm going to go with, actually, I'm going to go one post in front of you. I'm actually going with the 2 horse, and I'm going with O Captain. He's trained by Gustavo Delgado and ridden by Javier Castellano. He has been away for a little while, so he raced last in August of 21. He only had the 1 start, as you can see there. Very impressive, you know, for just 1 start, winning by 9.25 lengths, going away with Christian Torres aboard. It is a little concerning to see that he went to the shelf just so quickly there. Delgado does have a bit of a good track record here, 23 starts and gives himself 22% as far as horses who have been away for 3 months or more. And he does get Javier Castellano. I know everybody on this show likes Javier there. And I thought the horse who had shown good speed there in that opening race at the Maiden Special Weight Affair, I liked the way he looked coming into this one. And so I went with the number 2. Well, Captain.
Rich, just so that you know, we don't see the PPs on the screen right now.
You're not. Okay. Hang on. Let's see.
I know you're showing them here.
I'm sorry.
Yeah, I didn't see them. I just saw that we just saw the grid the whole time.
Let's see if I can't get that there. Does that?
Yeah, there we go.
Okay. Yeah.
There we go. Much better.
I was just trying to share my screen.
It's fine. It's fine. I mean, it's why I sent a message through the chat, so that's why I figured maybe you would. But I guess you didn't see that message. But no worries. It's funny. I went with the same horse Ray did. It is a tough race, and I would probably use a lot of horses if I were playing a pick 4 here. The horse beat an optional claiming field after a troubled start the last time. And Ray mentioned the strong jockey trainer combination, and the drills have been solid since. And Ray, I had the same thinking. I was like, I don't think 4-1 is realistic, considering the connections. That, you know, they're winning it. You know, 5 for 12 over the last 60 days. So I kind of guess that this horse will be the favorite more than anybody else would be. I don't think the morning line is accurate here. Not that it's easy to make a morning line, but again, based on the connections and the horse being undefeated, I kind of think this horse will be the favorite, and 5-2 is probably somewhat more realistic than 4-1. But if, hey, like you said, if we can get 3-1, 7-2, that would be fine with me. But the 3 of a Revolution is my top choice as well.
You guys still seeing the forms there?
Yes.
It's a good.
They're up now.
Good thing about preseason. And can you also see my screen now here over on that? This is your picks.
Yeah.
Yes. Yeah. Okay. It did switch.
Okay, so I got it back to I that was what I thought I initially had picked.
Yeah, no, it's fine.
Three and the
like
three.
I said,
And I must have only, I was only sharing the actual application. Then I switched over and I noticed I was only switching the, I was only sharing the,
okay.
The, so here, and I want to see if I can, and there it goes. Okay, so now I can put all that in.
Yeah, preseason, like you said, no worries. Yep.
This is the reason we're doing, it's the reason we're doing it. I've actually got some, I've got some abilities. It looks like at the very back end with editing as well, to be able to add some graphics and things like that. So if we want to throw a chalk eating weasel in there or something like that, we might actually be able to work something like that. So, all right. Cool. And I got your picks correct there, 3-3, and I got 2. Yep. All right. So we're good. Let's move on to race number 8. This is the non-stakes race in our event here. It is going 1 mile and 70 yards. If I'm not mistaken, and I'm hoping that someone out there in Twitter world will correct me, or maybe even Joe, I believe this is going on the new Tappeta track that they have there at Gulfstream Park. That's why you don't see anything over here showing you exactly, you know, how are we running today. It's not turf. It's not dirt.
Honestly, I don't know. It looked up at the top. It kind of looks like it is going over. You see the, to the right of the claiming price up on the top, right where it says Gulfstream Park.
Up here?
Yeah, right there. That's it.
Oh, yeah. Hey, oh, okay.
I didn't even notice it, to be honest with you. I figured it was dirt, but.
That is most definitely the synthetic track. No, I was.
Oh, they have the track. Oh.
Yeah, I was almost positive that.
Yeah, that was track. Yeah. Oh, okay.
So here we go. 1 mile and 70 yards. The purse is $22,000. It's for fillies and mares, 4-year-olds and upward, which have never won 2 races. And your morning line favorite is there in post number 2. Her name is Perfect Kimberly S. Trained by Stephen Dwoskin and ridden by Paco Lopez. And she is 3-1 on the Gulfstream Park morning line. And Joe, I gave Ray honors last time, so I'm going to give it to you this time. Who do you like in this?
Sure. I went with the 5 Titled Waters at 6-1. Only because in this girl is a sprinter who's stretching out around 2 turns for the first time. I like speed in cheaper races because generally the horses are lower quality and the horses that get in front often stay in front. And the jockey is pretty solid with speed types, even with a positive ROI. Of 23%. Again, I know, Rich, you probably know a little bit more about Edwin Gonzalez than I do.
Yeah, there's one of their top apprentices down there.
Yeah, and Trumbat is solid enough. I know he's pretty good in the Mid-Atlantic region. But again, basically, it's the speedy sprinter stretching out in a cheap race with a solid jockey with that type of runner. That's what drew me to the 5 Tidal Waters at 6-1.
Stay right there.
Oh, God. Toronto, right, you're killing me, man.
Yeah, but he's right here.
Me, Smalls.
Picked right here. Yeah, 5 Tidal Waters. I can't believe this.
You're killing me.
You know what? It's very similar. I was trying to get a horse to do something new. At 6-1, you know, I want to see how he handles 2 turns. He looked decent sprinting, so, you know. And stretch it out, but you know, you never know the stamina. But I wanted to take a chance at a price. Usually, as a favorite, you don't want to take that chance, but at a price, I'll take that chance. It looks like Trombetta sent the horse down to Florida, perhaps for the winter, because he was racing in Maryland, Pimlico, Laurel. Looks like he got a taste for the all weather track in the last race, and he ran fourth, not so bad. Looks like it says he's bumped twice early, so give him a little forgiveness there. He could be fully placed, definitely. And like you said, to 23% on the EP, which Brisnet stands for, like an early pace type of horse. And he's actually 20% too overall, so it's not a bad jockey. You don't know much about him, but you know, 1 out of 5, you know, we'll take that. And you know, I know Trombetta's is off to a slow start, 1 for 17, but he's also 15% for the year. So he's had some good horses, you know, throughout the year. So, but race like this, you know me, sometimes if I was playing my pick 4, I'd go for the old Keno machine because that might be what it takes to get out of this leg. But it's a tough race, and I'm just willing to go for, you know, low-priced horse. But Joe, we'll talk about the double, right?
I mean, it's funny if you look at the pedigree. The pedigree shows that the horse could go long.
Yeah.
If you look at Medalli d'Oro and Street Cry,
I
don't think overall stamina is a problem. I mean, I would have thought they would have tried something a little longer by now, but we'll see what happens. Again, cheap race.
I'm just one stall away from you guys once again here. So I'm on the six, either askew or askew, depending on who you like to call it there, like that, with Tyler Gaffalione aboard, one of my favorites down there at Gulfstream Park. Not that him and Jack Sisterson have any kind of a magic combination there, but the horse was by honor code. Only has had two races, so lightly raced, and comes out of a maiden claiming event. But that was on this very same Gulfstream Tap of the Turf, going a mile and 70 yards, so the exact same distance. And the horse came from a little bit off the pace. What I have seen from what I have seen at this track and what I have heard about this track is that it is very tough to win, being anything too far off the lead. But you do not want to be on the lead coming into the end. And so I was looking for a horse that could kind of fit that. And I believe Askew's got it. I also like the Calumet Farm connection here as well. So at 9-2, again, getting Tyler Gaffalione and Jack Sisterton there, I thought that was a good combination for me.
Yeah, Ray can't bet anything for Calumet Farm. You know that.
Yeah.
Calumet Farm is
he's got some kind of bad mojo with Calumet.
Combo for him.
Thank God. Yeah, it's funny because Calumet's like right. I mean, it's funny because Ray literally Calumet Farm is right down the street from Keeneland. Basically, it's right next door. Honestly.
All right. And let me just make sure that, again, I'm pretty sure I got your guys' picks because, again, I feel like I'm fighting a tag team tonight. Just the 5 and the 6. And we will move along to one of the co-features on the day, race number 9, going 1 mile on the turf. This is the Dania Beach Stakes. Purse is $100,000 for 3-year-olds only, and your morning line favorite, I believe, is out there in post number 5, trained by that guy Todd Pletcher and ridden by Luis Saez. Chansu is 3-1 on the Gulfstream Park morning line, and I'm going to go ahead and hop in first here before I find out that Ray and Joe have once again picked the exact same horse. And I went a little bit off the reservation this time. Again, I'm down in post number 6. Trained by Patrick Biancone and ridden by Rajav Marag. I went with No Nay Franklin out of No Nay Never. The horse, again, lightly raced, only had 2 races, and has actually never won a race, but finds him here or finds this horse here in the stakes race. Stretching out just a bit, had a nice performance there in a 5-furlong maiden special weight event back in August there at Gulfstream Park. And then followed that up with what was supposed to be a 7-furlong race on the turf as well. That's the Armed Forces. But it got washed off. The horse again had another nice second finish, had been leading into the stretch, and could not quite get it. You guys know that's actually one of my favorite little 4-letter words here in the racing game. I do love it when you see that game. The horse looks like he was interested. I like Patrick Biancone and Rajav Marag. Or Romero Romrog, a fairly decent rider down there. And you can see they've got at least a little bit of a connection there. They hit 25% together. So I ended up on the 6 yet again.
Go ahead, Ray. I went first last time. You can go. You all can right. Go before me.
Sorry about that. Yeah, I kind of left you hanging
don't
there.
Don't take my horse. not a tough race for me. I find this... I mean, unless, Pletcher dominates the board. But I settled on the 7. Gingrich for Brian Lynch, Paco Lopez. He had a 4 campaign in Kentucky. He had 3 good races. I mean, for the 2nd, 3rd, and then he finally broke his maiden at Keeneland. The quality of those races are pretty good for Kentucky Downs and Keeneland and, Churchill, even Ellis Park, too. So, this coming down to Gulfstream for the winter, they freshened this horse 2 months. and he's trying to win this for the first time. You know, a little concerned for me, but you know, at 6-1, you know, I take a little chance with this one. He looks to get some talent, and he'll be in the race. He probably needs to improve his figures a little bit. He's been running in the high 70s, and he topped out at 80. A few horses have better figures in this race, but they're mostly sprinting. So, I did look at his workout December 12th. I saw 5 furlongs and 58.3. That's pretty good. I mean, if that's the accurate print. And at Palmetto's? Yeah, Palmetto's. But I think Paco Lopez will probably be a little aggressive here. As you can see, the horse usually at the stretch had been first or third. So, you know, he's got a good turn of foot. And I think he'll be in the race. He'll probably avoid some traffic. Turf racing usually comes to either getting into the hole, you know, and on the rail or saving ground or getting a good trip. So trip is definitely going to be in play here. So I think from post 7, he'll probably get a decent trip and should be in the race. Gingrich for me.
All right, well, actually, we finally differ, thankfully. I went with the 4, Biz Biz Buzz at 5-1. I think he's coming out of, obviously, stakes races, so he's been coming out of the stronger races. He showed speed around 2 turns, even though it's 7.5 furlongs. It's a sprint distance, but it's 2 turns over the Gulfstream turf course. And the horse is graded stakes place in the Futurity. Even again, going 6 furlongs on the turf at Belmont. Again, I guess I'm on the Michael Trombetta kick this week. But again, I think he's going to have speed. He's going to, like Ray was saying, I think he's going to be able to break. If he breaks well, he'll go right to the front, avoid some of the traffic problems, and they'll have him to catch. And again, he's just coming out of stronger races for me. So I went with the 4. And 5-1 is not a bad price. You're going to get 5-1 because it's not a Pletcher, because it's not a Brian Lynch. Michael Trombetta is a good trainer in the Mid-Atlantic, but I mean, everybody will see 1 for 17, and they'll be like, I don't know, I'm not necessarily sure. But Pletcher will dominate the board, as you mentioned, Ray, I would guess. So I'll take 5-1 with Biz Biz Buzz.
You're one of my favorite riders there. You get Miguel Vasquez.
My favorite rider is the next horse that gets me to the winner's circle. It doesn't matter.
Yeah,
it doesn't matter to me. I don't care.
I have my favorite. So.
Okay, if I get a horse, if who's? I mean, I'm trying to think of who the worst jockey we could ever think of was. I don't even want to say it. Well,
before we turn this into a different show, let's go ahead and move along.
Go to Twitter, I'm sure, and find out.
Let's go ahead and move along to race number 10. This is the other co-feature for the day. They are going 1 mile on the main track. This is the Mucho Macho Man Stakes. Purse is $150,000 for 3-year-olds only, and your morning line favorite is right there in post number 2. Strike Hard, trained by Matthew Williams and ridden by Junior Alvarado, is 2-1 on the Gulfstream Park morning line. And once again, Ray, you know, we didn't get to have your brilliant presence here on the show last week, so go ahead and take a second turn around as the first first one with an open board, and let us know who you
think. Actually, on that page, Facebook page, I did make a little video. I don't know if in the comment section. I don't know if you got a chance to see it, but
oh, okay, no, I missed that.
Like a few minutes just to introduce myself and make a few picks. But you can check it out. You know, everybody can check it out. It's on the comment page, but. I was a fan last week who commented on the page. Strike Hard looks tough. 2-1 doesn't sell me. But I want to. I think the way this race is short field. I went all the way on the outside. Number 6, a graphic detail. William Mott, Louis Sires, who usually does very well at Gulfstream. Last year, he won the title last year. But I think with a record number of wins. But this was broken maiden Belmont. For me, kind of like professionally. I mean, he was slow, went wide, came up in time. Looked like he was probably looking for more distance, so Mile could be up his track. Most likely, they're looking for the going to Derby Trail with this horse, because his points in this race. Hopefully. Stepping up in class, you know, first-time winners, and the increase in distance. Hopefully, he'll like it. It's coming off the layoff. So I just don't know how far we want to go. Being out of practical joke. Dixie Union, got a little stamina there. But, you know, I guess he's going to try the mile, see how he does. And his practical joke is basically a one-turn horse. But let's see, you know, with graphic detail, if he'll get the distance. I like him being on the outside. He could, like, track the field, you know, see what they're doing. And, he could have difficulty catching strike hard. So that's what I'm leery about. If the track is a little speed favoring, whatever, because Strikeout has been proven in the mile and got the, you know, good figures there. He ran into optional claiming and, you know, he won a race pretty easily. So let's see. I'll give a shot with graphic detail and, you know, see how he does. This is the first race probably for Gulfstream and the Triple Crown Trail. So there are points here. So, you know, it could be important.
Are there points for this race? I was going to ask.
Sure.
I don't know.
Oh, they're not? Oh, I thought there was.
Okay. How about it, Joe?
Okay, and this is over the main track. This is not. I don't see the symbol there up at the top. Okay. Okay. It's funny, Ray. You were talking about Strike Hard, and he's the horse I like the best out of this whole card. And honestly, I would be trying to get through to the last race and get to him.
Single, yeah.
He's got a really good track record. He's got a good distance record. This is a one turn mile, practical joke would be fine around, you know, practical joke offspring should be fine around a one turn mile. I like the fact that Junior Alvarado stays aboard. He's one of the horses who's beaten winners before. And he won impressively that day. So he wheels right back and he's got tactical speed. He's not going to be somebody who's got to come around the entire field. He's going to be, if you look at the 3 mile races, you know, at the first call, he's within two lengths of the lead. And again, Gulfstream is infamous for wanting to, you want to be closer to the lead than you want to be further away. And I think this horse has everything that I would be looking for in a horse that I would want to single. I handicapped the race. I looked through everybody else and there are talented horses, but just, I just don't think as talented as Strike Hard is right now. I just think he's better than these. And I think he should win, you know, whether the price is 2-1 or, you know, 9-5, something in that range, that would be solid enough. And again, if you want to single a horse in a pick four, you know, that's a good enough price. It doesn't matter. You'll be okay as long as you don't chalk out in the first three legs. But again, Strike Hard was the horse that the best horse, the horse I liked the best of the four races. So I went with the two, even though he's the favorite.
No, and I hate it when this happens. But you know, what Joe said, I'm on the two as well. I did like the favorite here. We were a lot of us were handicapping without the odds because we are here on Thursday night. So it wasn't completely certain that I was on the favorite at that point in time, but when I saw it, certainly wasn't surprised either. He does look like the best horse in this particular race. I'm not really feeling all that familiar with Matthew Williams down there at Gulfstream Park. But all the other numbers and everything else that Joe brought up was very valid as far as I was concerned. So, I'm also on the two. In there. Got
it's funny that there's three horses in that race that are close to your odds money line. So,
oh, yeah.
You never know where the money's going to go. So,
absolutely.
You know, who brings the big bag to the track? You know,
again, I mean, and the one thing is it's horse racing, not trainer racing. So,
yeah.
Fortunately, I mean, if you see Matthew Williams and like Rich was saying, we don't, you know, I don't know very much about him either. And I know Rich handicaps a lot at Gulfstream, and I'm sure the name doesn't sound very familiar to you either. So I guess we're going to find out a lot more about him. Again, I didn't actually download the Formulator PPs. If I did, I probably would know more about him than I should, that I do. But again, it's, you know, the horse is solid enough.
Does that look right for everybody? Get your, I got your picks correctly?
Certainly is.
Yep. 3576.
All right. I will come back to you guys and we'll go ahead and say goodnight to everybody. All right. Well, you know what? This is, again, the end of about 7 years of handicapping together, specifically with the two of you, Ray Torado and Joe English. Steve Newsom, if you watch this, if you watch the replay, hi to you. And I'm sure he'll be
back. Steve, we missed you tonight.
When we come back from our break. So next week, we are taking a break. It looked like all of horse racing was taking a break as far as stakes races were concerned next week. So we won't do a tournament next week, but we will be back the following week. And we've got 2 more weeks left here in our preseason. Again, we will kick off our regular season on January the 29th. Well, Joe English, Ray Torado, I have said this many times, but it is always a pleasure to handicap with the two of you gentlemen.
Most definitely.
It's fun. Always like to learn.
Oh, yeah.
If you're not learning in this game, you're falling behind, you know?
Yep, yeah.
All right.
And it's not about the, you know, the betting and stuff. It's about the learning, the history, you know. And, you know, like you can go back 6 years ago and remember a horse, and now they're the sire or the grandsire or stuff. It's like, it's amazing how this industry goes. And that's what the best thing about it is, the history and, you know, just loving the sport, you know, watching the horses run. That's great. I love, you know.
Absolutely. Love of the game.
Right. Yeah. Love of the game.
Again, for Joe English and Ray Torado, and for Steven Newsom, who's not here with us tonight, but we'll be back. My name is Rich Sharp. This is called Tournament Horse Racing, brought to you by Broke Guys Handicapping. Joe, thank you for repping the shirt. And we will see you guys all back here in a couple of weeks. Thanks, everybody.
Happy New Year, all. 2022.
2022.